Okay, and so I wrote the title to try to get a bunch of you to come. I certainly don't have the answer of where the truth is. But can you read that? We need to turn off. Try this one. There'll be no math today, so you guys can relax. all right, so I want to talk a little bit about what science is, what science isn't, and why we do it, and why we pay for it, and just in general. Okay, and so you know, I have no magic knowledge about this. I don't have a degree in why science. So I'm just spouting stuff, and you guys will spout stuff. If you guys are too quiet, I'm just going to leave. You guys can just read this thing or something. So we don't want to do that. It'd be good if you guys participated. So the first thing I want to ask is let's just go around and see if we can get some ideas of how science is different than other disciplines. I mean, like academic disciplines, okay, and other ways of looking at the world. So start raising your hands. I will just call on you, even the ones who aren't in my class. You came here, so you're obligated to speak. So I'm going to start right with this one in the middle. REI sweatshirt. Yes.
Okay. Well, when you talk about how science differs from other academic disciplines, I think, you know, I was expecting a question like, how does science differ from, say, religious ways of viewing the world? In terms of other disciplines, I guess science assumes an underlying physical reality, that there's some sort of objectivity that, you know, might not be obvious, but is there, like, sort of the truth is out there somewhere, even if it's not perceptible to us, yeah.
Cool. All right, someone else. One of my students. Go for it. I'll alternate, picking on. Yeah, Henry.
Are you thinking of like the circle affair with the physicist who wrote the paper on what the why quantum gravity is a linguistic construct as a joke and submitted it to a postmodern? Basically, like, there's sort of like in that kind of field, your ideas have to stand, like, be internally consistent with like a bunch of logic, but they don't have to necessarily be consistent with, you know, experiment. Like, it's not provable, you know?
Cool.
So testable. We want falsifiable hypotheses.
Okay.
Most of the
falsifiable,
time.
Testable, objective, we heard. Anyone have anything else? Any other? I mean, you could talk about religious viewpoints. It's fine. I just meant how is science different? Anyone else have anything to add before we embark? It's cooler. I will call that a subjective observation, however one I agree with. Sarah?
Well, I think something that's important to consider is the difference between the way that we obtain evidence and the way that people in the fields of humanities might think of evidence. We have something called the scientific method that we use that's sort of a well-tested approach that we can use to try to be objective, as other people have mentioned. In humanities, a lot of times they'll build arguments based on letters that someone wrote to somebody else in some obscure place, and they'll sort of take one sentence and use that to build an entire argument around that. In science, we have a very different way that we use to establish facts and evidence.
Good. I encourage you all, there was an opinion piece in the New York Times last summer called "There Is No Scientific Method." It's absolutely fantastic. You should read it. We completely tore it apart in my seminar in the fall. But you should read it. It's quite fascinating. Okay, so let's embark, and hopefully decide on a few things that we can agree on about what science actually is. So I would say that science is a concerted human effort to better understand the natural universe, the universe around us. This includes both how things work and how we got here, so the history. So that would be, you know, evolutionary biology, cosmology, right, sort of the history of how we got here, and then the rules that everything has to play by. We often base this on physical evidence and logical reasoning. Okay, so I mean, in my mind, there really are two inseparable pieces to the way that we do science. One is we have to be able to observe something. We need to ground it in something that's real or physical or natural. And then we link together our own ideas and the different observations that we've made and other people's made with logical reasoning. Right? Often this involves mathematics. Logic and mathematics are heavily linked together. Ah, students, always late. So, the guests are allowed to be late. My students. I had my chalk. So you have to be able to use logical reasoning to link these observations together to build a consistent hypothesis or theory. We then test these with new experiments in a never-ending cycle, right? The idea is that you can never really know the whole truth, right? And so you have an idea about how it works, and you design a new kind of observation or a new kind of experiment to test it. And the real goal of those experiments is to prove something wrong, right? As Henry said, falsifiability is key. If your idea is not testable, it is not part of the canon of science. Okay? And if it is testable, the goal of an experimentalist is to prove it wrong. Design the key experiment that will, as simply and cheaply as possible, destroy the hypothesis, right? Allowing us to generate new hypotheses. So this, you know, this is all pretty, this is basically what was said by you guys. And I think that there's one key thing that I've struggled with a lot, that I think our society struggles with, and that's areas of science where you can't do what I will call an experiment. And by that I mean muck with the system. So you have a hypothesis or an idea about how it works, and now I can try to perturb or change the system and measure the response or the output of that and test my idea, okay? And in fields where you can do that, it's very clear how you test hypotheses and ideas and theories, right? You muck with it, you see what happens, and you say, did I predict that would happen? There are a large number of fields, both in science and outside of science, where you can't do this necessarily. Okay? And from my perspective, these are the areas that seem to be the most controversial in the public, because you can't directly go in and muck with it. Okay? So these are things like economics. Macroeconomics. We don't have extra little worlds to go make micro experiments where we take the whole government and like crash their financial system or something. We have the history of what's happened, so we can look back and you can form economic theories about why this crash happened or why that boom and all this happened. And then you can predict what's going to happen tomorrow, right? But you don't get to really do the key experiment. Same is true of climate science. Right? We definitely don't have extra planets to go mucking with. It would be great if we did, but we really, really don't. And so we have to look at what's happened in the past, combine it with things that we can measure and perturb, right? We know lots about fluid dynamics and how some things work in the atmosphere and the chemistry of lots of different things. And so we can combine that with all of our past observations and try to make good predictions about the weather or the temperature of the planet in 50 years. But we can't really do the key experiments, right? Evolution, another very, I mean, I guess not controversial. It was controversial. Okay, maybe it's still controversial.
Parts of the country is still controversial.
In my world, it is not very controversial. But in evolution, you largely cannot do the big experiments. Now, this is not technically true, as it isn't with climate science. So in climate science, there are parts of the planet that governments have walled off for doing perturbative climate experiments. Now, they're not macro experiments, right? You're not the whole planet. There's some, I don't know, tens of kilometers or something. But you can propose to the U.S. government to go to this one place in Colorado and really muck with the ecosystem to ask what happens. And there's a few of these around the planet. And so that's as close as we get in climate science to doing perturbative, direct experiments. In evolution now, there are some organisms that you can actually do some scale of evolution in the laboratory, and they've allowed us to really explore some of the evolutionary ideas that before were based solely on passive observations, now in a more active setting. But I think this is a really key point that separates many academic fields from other academic fields, where you can do an experiment or you can't do it. And so, in things where it's all based on observation, it's very hard in the public sphere to argue, well, you don't really know, to argue against the idea that You know, you don't know what's going to happen. How do you know what's going to happen? Just because it happened before doesn't mean it'll happen tomorrow. And that's, you know, you have to take a leap of faith. That one can extrapolate from past ideas, observations, into future, to sort of the behavior of the future. Okay, so why do people do science? So this one was already basically mentioned. It's super fun, right? Scientists do it because we love it. Because we like solving puzzles and problems and going out and mucking with things, and we think learning new stuff is super cool. You know, some of us like building things, some like blowing things up, and likes calculating things. But it's also a job, right? This is true both in academia, so you know, Ben gets paid to do this, I get paid to do this, the back half, a third of the back half of the room gets paid to do this. And so, you know, there are conflicts of interest, of course, that come up because our success as scientists is linked to, in some way, how much we discover or something like that. And so there is a motivation for us to discover many things and appear to be, you know, really on the cutting edge. This is maybe not the healthiest motivations at all times. And it's a job in industry, right? A lot of scientists don't exist in academia, they exist in industry, where there's a clear goal, right? You are there to design a new kind of technology to make a new hard drive. You are there to design a new technology to screen for drugs that'll battle something, or to mess with this whole class of chemicals to cure cancer. You are there for a specific reason, and that's still science. It's new things, you're discovering new things. There's also then a clear, but even more complicated set of motivations where your you know, promotions and your success as an industrial scientist depend on how well you do. But of course, then there's these real testable things, which is if you made money for the company or not. So it's even more complicated in the world of industrials. So this is why people like me and Ben, and et cetera, go into science. And so the question is, why does everyone else care about science? Now, maybe half of them don't. I hope they do. But you know, one of the biggest motivations that you'll hear from people, you know, in Congress who are pro-science is that science can improve people's lives, right? Through medical innovations and other technological innovations that are either a direct result of the science or a byproduct of the act of doing science. Right? So the example people like to use for that is the World Wide Web was developed as a way of chatting, essentially, for the particle physicists who are working on quantum experiments. Okay, and that then led to basically our whole lives. Now, I see you guys in the little thing. So, but that was a complete byproduct, right? Whereas other times, you know, the discovery of semiconductor technology, the discovery of certain properties of nanomaterials has really directly led to new kinds of technologies. And clearly, biological discovery often leads to biomedical discoveries and new treatments or therapies for lots of different things. Because you lead to medical and technological developments, this leads to economic development. Okay, so there's a really great story you should look up. I don't have time to tell it today. It's actually, my favorite is there's a radio lab. You guys know this radio lab thing? There's a radio lab episode on this guy, Fritz Haber, from Germany. And Fritz Haber, I think I may have told some of you this, is personally responsible for both saving all of humanity and almost destroying all of humanity. I mean, it's really an amazing story. And this was through mostly chemical technological innovations that, one, allowed farming to happen on a global scale when it couldn't before, but also allowed you to build both giant explosives and chemical weapons. So really, the two, you know, feeding all the people on the planet versus destroying all the people on the planet. It's quite an amazing story. But, you know, he first became famous because he developed a way of fixing nitrogen outside of plants. And so he could take landlocked countries that didn't have a lot of peat moss, et cetera, and all of a sudden now they could have fertilizer. Also made less, you know, was the reason they could grow things. There's also a sense, you know, that I think sort of waxes and wanes in history, but the idea that there's a basic human curiosity about why are we here and where, how do we fit in the universe, you know, at certain times in history, this is more appreciated than others, but that is certainly also a part of why society funds science. You know, it's sort of akin to the National Endowment of the Arts, right? It's how do we all work as a society? We're more than just little machines that make money, right? There's something more to it. And so that's another reason why we might care as a society about science. Okay, so I want you to, you know, pair up or triple up or something fun like this and just talk to each other for 5 minutes about different kinds of technologies that were stimulated by science that have changed society, and don't choose the obvious ones. Okay, I already gave you the internet. Penicillin is off the table. You know, like try to think outside of the box, because really as you look all over society, many things that we've done were influenced first by basic science, that then was utilized by engineers to produce new kinds of technologies or devices that have really changed the way we do everything. So go ahead, find some friends. The groups can be big, small. This room is not awesome for this, but just go for it. Okay. So I want to hear your weirdest ideas. I don't want to hear the normal ideas. So raise your hand if you have a particularly interesting idea. If you have no idea, I'm going to leave. I told you. You guys don't have ideas. I'm not ready. Yes.
Gutenberg printing press.
Very good. The printing press. Okay. And what was the scientific?
Probably the mechanization.
Okay. How to build levers and stuff. Okay. Great.
Actually, I don't think that's what it was. I think it was.
Ooh!
If I remember, he developed some new alloy that like made it possible to build a movable type of like that wasn't before.
Cool. I love it. You know more than not my expertise.
I might be wrong though.
That's okay.
Cool. All right, someone else, out of the box ideas.
Radio.
The radio, very good. And the technology behind that, all of my students who just learned something about this and are about to embark on this in a serious way. E&M what?
Thing.
Waves, all right, very good. Okay, excellent.
This is going to be controversial, but so in technology to develop internal combustion engine and harnessing fossil fuels.
I don't think it's controversial. I think that has changed society quite a lot.
Sure.
In many ways. So yes, combustion, MA used to be all about combustion. It is no longer. But okay, one more crazy idea.
Radioactivity.
Radioactivity. Okay. Yes, the discovery of radioactivity has had many, both useful and destructive implications. Very good. Okay, cool. Everyone said their piece? Okay, so how do we go from research in the lab to being accepted, right? And so this is the part that I think we're about to get into waters that, you know, I don't have all the answers, and I don't think it's exactly totally clear where the boundaries are in this thing. And this is part of the what makes science controversial at times, right? So we have a scientific method, and that involves partly motivating a particular project, finding what's been done on that project, evaluating the current state of the art, and then moving forwards in some small way by doing a new calculation, doing a new experiment, plus making a new kind of observation. And then to move from that to the public sphere, right, in academic science, what we do is we publish the result. We write it into a very old-fashioned manuscript, and we send it out, and a bunch of people we don't know tell us how stupid we are, and we revise this. It's just like writing stuff. And we revise it, and we send it back out, and they yell at us again, right? And then we do, what do you call it? R2, what do you guys
call
it? R1 and R2. So then we do our R2. And usually at that point you're okay. And you send it back, and the reviewers are so tired reading your paper that they say okay. That's some of the way it works. Okay, and then we go back in the lab, right? And we do it again. And we say, what's the next thing to do on that? Or we choose a new project or whatever, right? And that's kind of how science moves forward. In academia and medicine and in pharmaceuticals somewhat, journal articles really are the products of our research, okay? Patents in some areas are also involved as a product, but I would say by and large in academic science, in medical science, and pharmaceutical sciences, the journal articles are the end product. And they are what you are evaluated on. They're, in some sense, what everyone, all that will be left of you when you are gone, right? Something like this. And so, you know, this is complicated. We have to put all of our ideas, we have to prove them in some way to some group of people into these written manuscripts. And the more of them we write, the more money we will get paid, and more fame and glory will be showered down upon us. And so it behooves you to write a bunch of sexy papers. This is the truth of the way it is in academic medicine. Most people do not take advantage of this in a bad way. Some people do. It's a great skill to be able to write an exciting paper. So there was a guy at Bell Labs at some point in the 90s, I think, who wrote a Science or Nature paper every 2 weeks. He had one for like a year. And it turned out he just made up all the data. Okay? Which, you know, so one thing is, yeah, he's a bad guy, bad scientist, evil, we shouldn't let you know. But I actually think it's an amazing skill to be able to just to write a science paper, a nature paper, every 2 weeks. So for those of you who don't know, so science and nature papers are short, few pages, but they have to be super sexy, groundbreaking stuff. And so, you know, I personally don't think that I could sit down for a week, dream up a really amazing, sexy, crazy thing, make up the data for it, and then write a really polished draft and submit it every 2 weeks for a year. So that's like a beautiful skill, right? But unfortunately, there was not the data to support it. So Jan Hendrik Schoen, I don't know what... So he was caught because not only was he doing this, so first of all, he played soccer every afternoon. And his peers were like, I don't understand how he can play soccer all the time. And then he published the same graph twice with different axes to mean totally different things. And that was discovered here at Princeton, actually. And so then there was a big deal. Okay, I lost my... Okay, so in industry, outside of pharmaceutical industries, the knowledge actually stays in-house, mostly. In traditional industries for a very long time, either until patents run out or until it becomes reverse engineered so much that no one cares anymore, etc. In pharmaceutical industries, this is not true because to get a drug approved, you have to prove to the world that it's safe. And so the whole FDA process essentially ensures that all the research done, or much of the research done on a certain compound, ends up in the public sphere rather quickly. But in most of industry, this isn't true. So it stays hidden for a long time. It can be actually a very, very long time that companies will know things. Another area where you see this is in mathematics. So, you know, the NSA has large branches of mathematics that the rest of the world doesn't know. Mm-hmm. And are actually interesting mathematics. And, you know, and they keep it. And in fact, if you publish something similar, they go take it and they classify the thing you published. You can't tell anyone about it. They can, like, bet. It's quite exciting. But, yeah, and so, you know, you can argue about whether this is good or bad in all these spheres, in industry and in government and academia. But this is how it goes out into the public. And then the public reads it, both the general public and the scientific public. And they can decide to act on these papers. They can decide to follow up on them, to repeat the experiments. You can decide to make public policy based on these things. And if enough people do enough similar things with the similar sorts of outcomes, eventually these things kind of become established, right?
Well, actually, I was going to talk about this, because to say that the public, like these papers accumulate and then the public knows about it, they're not knowing it from the articles, right? There's a huge leap in many organizations between there. You take farming technology, right? They're, farmer is not going to read a journal article from the University of Iowa on how to,
yes,
you know, do no-till, right? They're going to have conservation societies, there's farm bureau meetings,
yes,
or like and even in our basic sciences, sometimes New York Times will come and interview someone, right? And so, and the paper's not published, you get a story directly to the people that's not been...
I totally agree. There is this intermediate step.
And so, yeah. So that, to me, is fascinating because the end users and the public are sort of trusting where they get their information from. And that's how we can interject doubt about climate change or embrace a technology that helps either climate change or medicine or... So these intermediate steps are...
I totally agree. I hadn't put this in this little presentation anything. So this is actually a very thorny point because most of it comes from reporting. So there are societies that go out and do advocacy broadly defined and are a bridge between the science and the user or something. But a lot of it does, particularly for things like, you know, climate change and evolution and stuff, it comes from reporters. And reporters have a very specific, they want to hear an actual reporter.
Before I lived at Daily Prince, so like
that's not what you're so the reporters, I mean, they really view their goal is not to tell the public what you think. It is to do an investigative project and discover, I don't know what they call it, not the truth, but whatever they call it. And so, for example, if a reporter comes to you and talks to you about some work you've done and wants to write an article about it, they will almost never let you read the article before you. They don't care what you think is important. And, you know, in my mind, so there's good and bad to this, right? So the good thing is the whole point is you're not supposed to be able to manipulate the press. Fine, free press is great. The bad thing is you have to really make sure they understand it and that they don't misrepresent. So what they will do is they will read back the quotes that they're going to use for you to make sure that the quotes are accurate, usually. They actually don't have to do that. They'll usually do that as a courtesy. They always remind you how much of a courtesy that is. But like, in science, you know, you really don't want the professor saying something just blatantly wrong. So I think that's okay. But then the rest of the article is their interpretation of the science, and they are in almost never qualified to do this. Right? And so this is a very dangerous, tricky thing. I don't have an answer to it, but I've encountered this many, many times. It's a very tricky thing. And you know, what you say to the press really matters. So at some point, I was a graduate student at Stanford. I was studying molecular motors, and there was a quote in some magazine somewhere about how me, a Stanford scientist, you know, a student, but anyway, they didn't say that, Stanford scientist, that these molecular motors are totally amazing. You know, we don't know how they work, and so they're really exciting to work. And so I was like the poster boy for creationist intelligent design, because Stanford scientists didn't know how they work. Even the fancy, smart Stanford scientists. It was like totally ridiculous. So yeah, it's very dangerous, this sort of thing. Okay. We should move on. I think this is something that many people don't understand, including many scientists, particularly when they're starting out. And this is that science is always about change. Right? The best you can ever hope for is to contribute to the evolution of our knowledge about the world. That's the best a scientist can hope for. Right? There is no way that the thing that you discover tomorrow and publish and make your whole career on is the end. It just can't be, because you can never get to the ground, to the end truth. And so science is always changing. Usually it changes very slowly in a very boring way. Sometimes it changes in dramatic ways, like we saw with Maxwell's equations and the wave equation for light last week. But our present theories are the best explanation we have now. Right? And I think, you know, we see this in our language that we use. As I've mentioned to you guys before, we use the word law for all sorts of things that we then prove are wrong. Right? Like, we wrote down this law, and then we said, well, you know, that's only true if things aren't moving. And if they're moving, we have to add this term to it. So how the hell is it a law? Right? Like, it's not a law. But it's just got that name, and we use it historically. But this, you know, this terminology is really quite dangerous. So let's do, I guess we're moving on. I was going to do a discussion here, but we have too much to do. But, you know, this is just controversial. In the sense that I don't think there's an answer. And different people have different answers. When do you say you've learned something? In fact, in science, different fields have essentially different definitions of the word know. K-N-O-W, not N-O, I think. So, you know, in one field of science, it may just be describing a new little bit of something. Could be a really valuable piece of something. You could say, well, I understand it because I described it. In another field of science, that would just be the very starting bit, and you really wouldn't declare any kind of victory until you understood how it related to everything else, or something like that. And these very different standards and very different definitions are different. You know, when should we move something beyond the theory? Should we ever move something beyond the theory? Is theory just the best word? I kind of think it is. Your current theory is your best, is the one you have, right? We don't graduate it to a law, because I will tell you what, it will be wrong, no matter what. You know, we have almost a grand unified theory of physics. It's certainly wrong. Everyone knows it's wrong. Right? There's no way it's right. You're just not going to get to the right thing. This I put in just because of recent events. It's not so easy. Okay, I'm not defending the use of other kinds of facts, but what do you call a fact? You know, I mean, there are some things that you can call facts, but there's many things you'd like to call facts that aren't facts if you think of them in a scientific context. Right? There's lots of things we just can't know. You can never declare certainty, and so there's always a window of doubt, and this leaves open a window for people who may disagree with the way you think you should interpret the science to interpret it differently. Right? And so this is the cause of, I think, basically all of the business that led to the day of action, I guess. Okay, we only have 12 minutes, so we'll have to be a little faster. I mean, the what science is was more exciting. So what isn't science? Some of these actually I think are pretty important. So, you know, before the advent of modern science with Galileo, and Kepler and Bacon and others, right, you combine deductive reasoning, which is good, logic, reasoning, all very good, with notions of perception and beauty. And that is how you deduced the laws of the world. Okay? And what Galileo and others, you know, brought to the table is that, no, you should combine deductive reasoning with observation. Right? So it's more than just reasoning. And in particular, it's more than just beauty. Now, this is something that trips up lots of people in different fields of science. We are attracted to beautiful, simple, perfect-looking theories of how the world works. It is natural in us to want to believe those over messy things. They just seem so much prettier and cooler and satisfying. Okay? And as a motivation for studying something or for doing a particular kind of measurement or theory, it's okay. But you have to be willing to throw out the idea that the laws of nature are beautiful and symmetric and or something. Right? You have to be able to throw that out if you discover that this is not true. Okay? Evolution, as many of you know, clearly doesn't design things to be beautiful. Sometimes they are. Amazingly beautiful. And sort of perfect in some way that you're just like, that's so cool when you figure it out. But many times it's not. And you have to be able to throw out the ideas of perfection and beauty when looking at, objectively, with reasoning and logic, at the observations or the experiments that you've done. Science also isn't art. Okay? In art, we have this conception that there's an artist. The artist has ideas and emotions that they express, and then we take those in and we interpret them as ourselves, and all of that is part of the artistic process. Science is not that. There is no artist. There aren't these things. That is not how it works. Okay. And so it really is a very separate thing. I would argue that science also isn't just the expansion of ideas. Making more observations is not necessarily, you know, significant progress in science. Not that it's not science, but it's not just the expansion of ideas. Making the book of knowledge bigger is not necessarily our goal, or longer. I think many of us think that it should be getting longer, but then eventually parts of it contract, because you realize you were looking at the same thing in different ways, and now you can combine chapter 3 and chapter 5, or something, and so it gets a little smaller, and then it gets bigger and smaller and bigger and smaller. Science isn't technology. And in particular, science is not about truth and certainty. We cannot have those things in science. And so any concept or way of speaking or thinking that involves truth and certainty in scientific discourse is just fundamentally flawed. And it represents a misunderstanding of what science really is. Okay, we don't have time to do this. This is an interesting one. We don't have time to do this. Okay, so this will be the end. Science is expensive. Okay, so how did science originally start? Well, courts, you know, with kings and queens and etc., had all the money and all the power, and they thought it was fun to have pet scientists. You know, both for technological reasons and just because it was part of the ethos. And so they would fund them, right? They would pay for their livelihoods and their little experiments or whatever. And usually, those weren't terribly expensive. Nowadays, science is ridiculously expensive, as you know. There's many reasons for this. There's a lot of scientists, is one, right? A lot of science money goes to paying people. It doesn't go to buying big machines. So there is some big machines, but a lot of it goes to paying people. Right? So there's a lot of scientists. There are also giant machines, you know, that like span countries and stuff, and these cost a lot of money. And, you know, there's various reasons it costs a lot of money, and so you have to ask, you know, rich organizations to contribute money to doing science. Governments contribute money for many reasons. I think the reasons they will tell you depend on what decade you've asked them in. But all the reasons that we talked about why society cares about science, the governments have at least claimed at one point or another. It's often motivated by technology in the end, if you push them into a wall. Private foundations also fund science. So that would be, you know, rich charitable organizations, the Pew Charitable Trusts, etc., the Packard Foundation, who fund rather large swaths of science. The amount of funding is nowhere near what you get from government, but they often are free of the sort of regulatory shackles that come with large bureaucracies and governments, so they can do interesting things. And then corporations, and I mean this by, you know, for-profit businesses also fund science for their own, you know, money-making motivations, which is fine, right? They want to make money, so they will fund lots of people working on quantum computing, because the first people to get quantum computing not only crack everyone's codes, but also will rule technology for a couple decades, right? And so corporations sink a lot of money into this, government sinks a lot of money into it, and so that's it. Okay, at this point, I thought we could have a brief discussion before. So my students will leave at 50 after, because they all have to run their class. The rest of you are welcome to stay to 11 if you want, but what thoughts do we have? Based on all this nonsense. I talked too much. I wanted there to be more discussion, but it went too slow in the beginning. So I want you guys to talk some. You know, why are we here? What are the big problems with science? What is science? I don't believe in science. What is it you want to say? Whatever it is you want to say. I'll just call you. Jane, I'm calling you.
Okay. I have a question, actually, and that's that the scientist author's name is always associated with, closely associated with the journal article, and that's how one builds one with its reputation. So I've been pushing this orchid, so authors have unique identifiers that tie them.
Yes, you want us to tattoo a number?
Yeah, a tattoo number. But there has been some pushback, especially when the government is asking for the names of the people involved in this kind of research or something, and in a way that facilitates that process. So,
I don't know about all this pushback. I don't know.
I guess it's the, not the pushback, but I have problems. Am I doing a good thing or bad thing? Because it's making it easier to identify who's doing what and exactly who's doing what. And the fact that the government asked the Department of Energy for a list of the names of people working?
I don't know. I mean, we all have access to Google Scholar.
Yeah.
Which I think basically tells you what everyone is doing.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's so broad. Yeah.
Okay, someone else with funny comments? Anyone want to know why it is your taxpayer dollars pay for journal articles you can't read? Well, all of you can read it if you're sitting in this room, but if you're not sitting in this room, some of you can't.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
I have a just general comment, because you could probably tell I don't come from these parts. I am from rural Iowa, and my family are farmers and teachers and educated and not educated. And I think that half of them would be just shocked by half of what you had up there. Science isn't truth. There aren't facts. You know, all this stuff. I believe it. I embrace it. I escape from there. But I think that this is an echo chamber.
Oh, I totally agree.
Right? So as long as
this wasn't my idea.
No. But I don't know. Is there anybody here who was surprised by anything that was up there? I mean,
sure. Who was surprised by
something? You know, and then how do you address that with someone when I go home to talk to these people, you know? This is the problem. This is the divide in this country right now. So if anybody's got good ideas for how to, you know, they don't have to understand everything we do at the same level, but the interpretation of what we know and how we apply it, I mean that's the key.
I think the idea that there aren't facts needs to have the caveat that what we consider the closest thing to facts is the greatest consensus of the most informed people about the subject. So it's not just guesswork to say it's not a fact doesn't mean it's not true, it's just the best understanding we have. Right? So that's the caveat that I think we in the room understand that the people you're talking about need to also be informed.
Yeah. So there's an issue with this, which is some of the best science is done by the people who don't go along with the consensus.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Some of the really big breakthroughs are the people who said, that's crap. I don't buy it. Right? And so right now, you know, we have some of them on this campus that are, they go work for the White House, and people say, oh, they're totally full of crap, and I'm not saying they're not. But that way of thinking is often, you know, celebrated in the end, because it can lead to the biggest breakthroughs. It's very subtle, right? I mean, the big problem is this is all very subtle. None of it is black and white, right? We can't just go and say, yes, no, fact, fiction, this will happen tomorrow, it will snow tomorrow. Sometimes.
But our equivocations lead to astounding policy effects downstream, right?
Yes.
I mean, equivocation on what's going to happen next in climate change is not equal to there are threats from ignoring it, right? So, it's how do we communicate the level of uncertainty attached to any bit of knowledge? And that, you know, we want to be true to scientists saying we don't prove things, we disprove hypotheses, but we have a level of confidence in this.
Yeah.
So.
Now we have to do it in 38 characters.
That's the
I mean, you mentioned several times it's been brought up that there's sort of science puts forth journal articles, and then there's a process before that information is communicated to the public, and there are a diversity of players involved in that process. And you mentioned yourself that reporters aren't going to communicate what you interpret as the message of your research. And so I think that controlling some of the way that message is communicated to the public is part of this conversation. How involved do scientists get in actually publicly communicating their work outside of journal articles? But it's a bit of a catch-22 because there's also a lot of scientific credibility that is undermined by more informal forms of communication and more assertive claims in a field that values uncertainty.
Yes. There's more comment? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was surprised. I honestly thought that science was a sort of step towards truthfulness, knowing that we didn't know
it. I mean, I think science is steps towards truthfulness with the reality that you are here. Great philosophical question. Yes.
Well,
just talk louder. They're going to leave. It's fine.
Around this whole day of action, I was thinking, thinking that one of the figuring out the nexus of how to think. What do people think about in this room and some of the other rooms in this building around science, and kind of how we talk to and deal with the fact that there's a lot of things, people that don't believe in science for political, cultural, religious reasons, and how do we, more of a sociological thing, how do we interact with those people and
yes,
find a way
to
kind of, that's really kind of the real big issue. Really, kind of, there's science, but then there's people that for a lot of reasons that are very real to them, don't believe in things, and they have conflicts within themselves for religious and cultural reasons. So how do we work around that challenge?
Yes. So I've gotten a lot of in some trouble with some scholars who know more than I do. But in many ways, science is similar to a religion itself. I've been convinced that by whatever definition they use in a different department, it's not a religion. But whatever. It's basically a religion. Founded on these ideas that we just talked about for now. Right? But you have to believe in the core principles, right? You have to believe that that logic works.
Can we call it a philosophy?
That also, okay, there's departments who don't like either of these. So we can call it whatever you want. But it is a belief system, right? That deductive reasoning and logic should lead you from A to B in a predictive fashion. Is something you have to believe in. It's a leap of faith in right. some sense. And so if you just don't have that belief, I don't think there is any way of really doing the form of communication or convincing that it can't happen.
Yeah. I mean, it must be a tremendous. I mean, my father-in-law is a devout Catholic, and he's also a scientist and worked in pharmaceuticals and whatnot. And he believes in Catholicism and all the. It goes around with that belief, but he also, on the other side, is in science to a high degree. He's got a lot of, I've never addressed this with him, but there'll be a lot of internal conflicts because they don't really run in parallel when you think about those things, right? You got to think a lot of
I happen to agree with you.
I think they may not even register to have those conflicts.
Yeah.
They not.
People just compartmentalize really easily.
Yeah, yeah. But a lot, exactly. But a lot of other people where you're trying to, how do you cross that divide? When it really matters, when you're talking about climate change and evolution. I mean, half the Congress doesn't even believe in evolution. I mean, the most basic thing, right? And so how do you cross that divide with somebody?
Yeah, it's more than half.
I've spent hours trying to do that with both pastors that my parents put in front of me to talk. before we moved here, we lived in Omaha, Nebraska. Which is the bluest part of that red state. And my neighbor would say, well, how do you just know about evolution? I said, well, you've known me now for a few years. You know I'm a scientist. I go into a lab and I have these ways to see that DNA changes. And we have ways to see, well, we know DNA exists. Hey, we know it exists. We know that changes occur. And we know that the environment changes. And we know that we're all alive today. I said, these are a set of observations. These are things we can deduce because, he's an old retired farmer, right? These people know that when the wind blows from the north, it's the weather, the temperature is going to drop and it's going to snow.
Right.
We use these things to infer what's going to happen next or what has happened.
Yes. And science is also predictive, though. That sets it apart.
Right.
Apart from that economic, that's
and
why
so
economics
I said,
is
I cannot convince you, but I can tell you that if you know me, and you know that I am a logical, nice person who doesn't lie, and I mean, that's kind of it. I can't convince you, but, maybe you plant a seed. Well, she's a little younger. She might know something different. I don't know what the answer is. The thing is, I've learned is never take it head on. Never try to think you're
going
to
convince someone. Then people dig in, right?
Yeah.
And that's what I think we're facing now. There's so many, it's not just religious beliefs, then you've got some cultural beliefs, and then they're sticking to their guns because they feel marginalized, so then they're even blocking themselves off even further. So, there's a hill to climb right now.
It's
getting
bigger. Right now, to my family, I'm the East Coast elite other.
Oh, sure.
But I came from that dirt patch,
But then you found the promise. There's a class here in in 2 minutes. We unfortunately have to leave. This was very good. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.